Hello, my name is Rebecca, and I am from the South. I am actually from Memphis, Tennessee, or as they say there, Memphis. You know what that is? Elvis. Because the Elvis is from Memphis. But Memphis is known for other things. I mean, it's known for the blues. Yeah! You got blues? Right, yeah! It's known for barbecue! Yeah! It's the home to the original Federal Express Hub! Packages! Yeah! Let's see, it's where Martin Luther King was shot! That's not so good. Yeah, going back to Memphis, it's like visiting another country. I know I tend to forget this, but the South was its own country at one time. And we lost that war. And we didn't just lose it. We were defeated. And my Aunt Kathy explains that's why Southerners have an inherently different approach to tragedy. When she first left Memphis, she moved up to New England. And her first winter up there, she experienced a really intense ice storm, the kind where tree branches are weighted down by ice, and as they fall, it sounds like explosions going off. The next morning, her neighbors are out there cleaning and shoveling and restoring order, and Kathy is simply paralyzed and in awe at what nature had wrought. I just don't understand how the Yankees can get out there and clean it up before they have time to absorb the magnificence of the disaster. Those are words of a true Southerner. After all, what's a disaster if you don't have time to marvel in it? This is really bad. I just don't know what we're going to do. Yeah, ghost of the Confederacy. My grandmother, Lucy, she lived out on acres and acres of land in this large house that she and my grandfather had built. It had a swimming pool and a man-made lake and an enclosed back porch where you could sit in the decadent humidity and linger in the tragedies of the less fortunate. While two or three maids in the house and people were out there picking cotton. Well, it wasn't that bad. We had progressed. But Spencer and Eli were always out there picking and tending to something. Now, Lucy was very good at cutting off conversations that did not interest her. So my visits out there were full of long pauses while I struggled to find a safe topic to discuss. One time, the subject of blueberries brought some conversation comfort. Rebecca, do you like blueberries? Yeah, I do. I do like blueberries. In fact, I was thinking that blueberries are probably blooming around this time of year. Can you get Rebecca some blueberries? And like magic, we're served freshly washed blueberries. So over champagne, cigarettes, and blueberries, we briefly bring up politics. I'm not voting for Gore. Do you want me to go to the poorhouse? No, I wouldn't want that, no. It's so pleasant out here. But I'll go see if Claire can get me some more champagne. You see, it's hard to talk about the South without talking about the South. And I had read about the long ago plantation days when I was in elementary school. And it was around this time that my mother was inspired by an idea. Rebecca, I don't think you realize how fortunate we are. I want you to ride the Memphis public bus to school. And so it was. Me and all the black maids heading out to East Memphis. Me in my school clothes, bag of books, most of them in their uniforms. And I was aware that we shared different histories. I would open up my social studies book to the picture of Harriet Tubman so they could clearly identify what it was I was learning. I seek to be as naively progressive as my mother. Mama got me on that bus, and she also got me on a bus out of the South in her insistence that I go east for college. So off to Massachusetts I went, a state where everybody seemed to know where they're from. Rebecca, what's your ancestry? Well, I'm white. They wanted to know more. I mean, they wanted to know if I was German or Irish or a blend. I mean, where I was from, you were either black or white. It was pretty simple. I mean, I did know that I was a great, great descendant of Meriwether Lewis. You know, of the Lewis and Clark expedition? I mean, you know, I know this because like 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 people in my family have the name. And speaking as one of the many, it's something to be quite proud of. You know, I mean, the guy literally contributed to the shape and form of our country. He also committed suicide. Not so good. But where was I? Going back to Memphis. When I used to go back to Memphis for vacations and holidays, it began to feel less familiar to me. Our house was rather large to me. It was a 3-story cream-colored house with Greek Ionic columns that circled at the top and large circular indentations. And it had 2 royal blue flower pots that looked like fountains on the front porch. This all sat on an acre of land in Midtown Memphis. I walk into the house, and Liesta Redmond is wearing the blue uniform she'd change into when she got there and out of before she left. She's wiping down the kitchen counter with a yellow sponge. Hi, Liesta.
Oh, hey there, baby. How you doing? Miss Fisher told me you'd be coming to town.
She did? I didn't see her car out here. Do you know where she is?
Where'd she go? She told me where she go. She went the cleaners. That's where she went, to the cleaners.
Okay. Well, will you tell her that I'll be upstairs when she comes home?
Okay, baby. Good to see you. Good to see you.
Good to see you, too. I walk up the front staircase. It takes up like half the house on the first 2 floors. And along it are larger-than-life-size portraits of my parents with these white backdrops. My mother, she's painted in a greenish-brown color. And she's holding a bouquet of flowers, and her head looks kind of smushed. She actually looks trapped, like she's trapped in a formal setting. Up the next 6 stairs is my father's portrait. It is slightly smaller. He's wearing a leather suit with fringes on the sleeve, and the words Omega Flower are written across his chest. He's holding a rifle, a bandana, and a cowboy hat. There's a self-assuredness about him in this fantasy. He actually kept a set of guns underneath he and my mother's bed. They were never used. They just lay there, stirring up this feeling of decayed adventure. I quickly retreat to the attic. Oh, a floor of ordinary landscape with its green wall-to-wall carpet and white walls. Yes, in the 9th grade, I moved up here to join the castaways. Here we lived, the extra dresser drawers, the lamps, the electronics, all of us having no space downstairs. I walk into my room and see that it's 4:30, that time of day when realities of existence begin to sink in on a visceral level. I've come to call it afternoon existential living, and it requires no other remedy but to simply lie down with the hopes that it leaves upon waking. Oh, I'm awoken to the distant sound of Carl Castle and Cokie Roberts blaring from the radio downstairs. NPR was our transition song. Our anthem, our call to action. In the morning, it woke us up. And in the afternoon, it gave us this validation that we made it through the day. It was something larger than we were. Oh, no. The territory begins to feel unfamiliar to me. I once belonged here. How can I assimilate? I see my brother Adrian. His 6'3 stature looks slumped, his eyes small and tired looking. Hi, Adrian. Oh, hey, Rebecca, how you doing? You back in town? Yeah, I just came in town for a little bit. What are you doing? Oh, man, I just got a headache. I gotta lie down. You gonna be here later on? Yeah. Oh, no, actually, no, I was gonna go out with some friends, but maybe I'll see you later? Yeah, Rebecca, good to see you. Snowball. That's what they called him, Snowball. And I used to think it was because he was the only white guy that hung out on the streets. Turns out, it's because he did so much cocaine. And I began to think, if I had a street name, what would it be? I think it'd be cool if it was Glow. No, Glowball. Yeah. Ooh, yeah. Oh, I like that. Yeah, this is my sister Glow. Yeah, this is my brother Snow. Glow and Snowman got the groove. Glow and Snowman bust a move. Ooh, I like it. Glow, keep yourself shining. Ooh, I will. I'll be shining all night. Ooh. I like having a nickname. It makes me feel important. I mean, I could understand why you wouldn't want to give all this up. I mean, if everybody's calling me Glow, and then suddenly I hear Rebecca! Shit, did I lose my glow? I'd start shining myself up, get myself glowing again. Yeah. Adrian and I were always missing each other. But with siblings, there's always the possibility of connecting. We share the same parents, and that is a pretty big common ground. I guess we'll start to bond tomorrow. My mother comes around the corner fiddling with one of her mini bobby pins, all placed in her red hair in an effort to pull it back. Well, Rebecca, I just had a sinking spell. She always said it as though it was an unexpected occurrence. But sinking spells have been around for years. Yeah, I just had to lie down if I was going to make that 10:30 class. I mean, I was going to make the 5:30 class because I missed the 10:30 class. Oh, at that new place you were telling me about, the place where you go to aerobics now. Yeah, Rebecca, the Baptist Healthplex. You would not believe the squats that we do. I mean, I am sore for days on these. Rebecca, maybe you can come to that 5:30 class with me. In high school, Mom and I used to have these huge fights that reverberated throughout the whole house. Rebecca, are you talking on the phone? Gotta go. Rebecca, were you talking on the phone? Yeah, I was just talking to Andrew. We talked about school. God damn it, get off the goddamn phone! Okay. But I knew on the nights it got really bad, she'd come upstairs and crawl into bed with me and hold me. It was her way of saying she was sorry. Since I'd gone away to college, we gotten closer, you know, as best we could. I taught her how to say, I love you. Mom, I love you. Well, I love you too. It was this beautiful and awkward expression of growth, and it felt like she was having this growth in all these areas of her life, and it was at the dawn of this change that she was murdered. Totally valid question. She was brutally killed 10 years ago. Thank you. I'm okay. Yeah. Are you okay? I mean, I hope I didn't say too much. But you know what they say in things like this? They say, I mean, I know it's a lot. Believe me, I know it's a lot. But you know what they say? They say, the proof's in the pudding. No, my dad says that at certain times. No, a rolling stone gathers no moss. So I like to think of these experiences as the moss that keeps my texture interesting. You see it, right? The moss? Oh, wait, it must be growing on my back. I'm not rolling away. You see, it's just been growing on my back. Where was I? Oh, Mama in aerobics. If she wasn't running off to class, she was bending and stretching throughout the house. When I was in high school, I used to have friends come over and spend the night.
The next morning, we congregate in the kitchen to talk about the night's events, and Mama would come in there feigning disinterest in the conversation. Then she'd find things to do in the kitchen, you know, to keep herself occupied. Oh, so did you go over to the Sheridans last night? Is that where the party was? And I knew once her leg had hit the kitchen counter, she was ready to dive in. Well, I heard that Scott Sheridan's parents are getting a divorce. Now, was the father there at the party? Rebecca, if we're going to make that 5:30 class, we'd better get going. We jump into her blue Oldsmobile station wagon, and we head over to the Baptist Healthplex. Now, this may conjure up images of Christians doing leg lifts or reading the Bible while on the treadmill. No, Mama had a funny thing about Christians. She called them those people. No, it was everyday people there. She went on talking about the people, the classes, the squats. You would have thought it was the land of promise the way she talked about it. And once we arrive, it's just this huge, nondescript warehouse-looking building. We park the car, and as we walk away from the car makes this loud rattling, I need help! Help me! Mom, you need to buy a new car. Rebecca, I am proud of my rattling car. Not everybody can go out and afford to buy fancy new cars. Okay, I backed off that one. I could tell she was protective of the illusion that she shared the same financial confines of those of her new friends. Here, everybody assumed she was a hard-working Democrat who didn't have to work for some reason. Or as my father used to tease her, a limousine liberal. We walk into the building, and people notice her. She does her wonderful wave, nod, smile. Wave, nod, smile. Wave, nod, smile. She leads me over to get the mats and the weights. And that is when Gary, a tall, muscular queen, takes the stage. Okay, everybody. Let's start with some stretches and stretch, stretch, stretch. Mama turns to me, she says, Gary's gay. He's got a black boyfriend. I guess times are changing right here in this Baptist workout warehouse. And I say, bring it on! We continue through a strenuous amount of jumping and squatting and stretching, and we make our way to the floor work. At which point, I'm completely exhausted, and my 52-year-old mother is showing much more strength and endurance than me. Oh, Mom, you're really strong. Well, Rebecca, it takes practice. I want you to meet Gary. Emily Fisher, where were you on Monday? We missed you. Well, Gary, I want you to meet Rebecca. Well, of course she looks just like you. I can tell the resemblance. She told me you were coming in town. She did? Emily, look, I want to stay and talk to you, and meet you, Rebecca, but I got to go. Lawrence's car's not working. I swear one of us is going to have to start riding the bus to work. But look, Emily Fisher, we better see you at Monday Margarita. Your mama is so much fun. Margarita Monday? Margarita Monday? My mother. Mom, I think it's great that you've made all these new friends. Well, I'm glad I could share it with you. So am I, Mom. So am I. families out there. You know what I'm talking about? You got the outdoor family, you know? They go on walks, they camp, they spend the night in the woods. We weren't like that. That was not our thing. There was like the artsy family, you know? Everybody does something. Everybody's got their special art skill. We were that. That was very good. That was good. The drinking family. Yeah! We were that. That was not good. The dog family, you know, they walk their dogs. They got needle-pointed pillows with their dogs' names on it. I got pictures of their dogs. Something about dogs and cars, we had trouble, you know, it was just, couldn't get that down. I remember our first dog was a little Cocker Spaniel that Lucy gave me for Christmas. And one spring, Mama and I came home from church, and Oliver was lying on the front porch with a bloody nose. Mama, what's wrong with him? I don't know. Your father must have forgotten to put him back in before he left. Do you think he's gonna be okay? That night, my father comes into my bedroom wearing only his white boxers, and I could tell he'd been drinking. Rebecca, I need to talk to you. Oliver died of internal bleeding. Internal bleeding was confusing to me. How could he have looked okay on the outside but have been dying on the inside? Rebecca, it can be hard to lose a dog. Do you want to talk about it? Tell you what, Rebecca, we'll get a new dog, Rebecca. We got a new dog. Oliver Jr. was his name. Yeah. My brother and I found his body in the neighbor's garbage can. Rebecca, come here. He looks okay, but his head is smushed. Ah, but our third dog, Oliver Sr., smashed to smithereens with no recognizable corpse to bury. All of this deeply entrenching an anxiety disorder and laying the foundation for larger scale tragedies. Those poor fishes, they have such trouble keeping dogs. Get one, boom, it's killed. Get another one, boom, it's killed. Boom, boom, boom. Those children are gonna have trouble making any real attachments. Between me and you, I do not think that they should have dogs. It's right after college. I'm living in Chicago. It's my first apartment and the first day at my new temp job. I come home and there are four messages on my machine. Rebecca, it's Daddy. You need to give me a call as soon as you get this message. I'm over at Mary Ann's house. The number here is 901-452-5030. Doesn't go over there much. Rebecca, it's Adrian. You need to call Daddy as soon as you get this message. He's over at Mary Ann's house. Rebecca, it's Kat. You need to call your daddy as soon as you get this message. He's over at Mama's house. There's been a terrible accident. It's weird. Why isn't Mom calling? Rebecca, it's Kathy. I'm going to fly to Chicago tonight, and then I thought we could fly to Memphis together tomorrow. We couldn't get back into the house. There was a yellow caution ribbon wrapped around it. We all descended upon my Aunt Mary Ann's house, where food and flowers came every time the doorbell rang. There was a colored card index system created in the kitchen to document the generosity saturating the house, and sharp black bean soup picked up family from airport, Walgreens for ice. The front page of the Memphis Commercial Appeal had a large color photograph of my father talking to three police officers outside of our house. Intruders stab arts patron, beat maid, ransack home. Police say Fisher and her maid were the only ones at the house. Fisher was brutally stabbed and suffered several stab wounds, the maid beaten. The maid was too distraught Monday to give the police much assistance. Well, of course the maid is too distraught. My brother takes a cab to Marianne's house. He shows up with cigarette in hand. Hey, Rebecca, they're talking about it on the radio. Yeah, look, Adrian. Look, Adrian, if you know anything, you can tell me. I didn't say that. Yeah. Come on in. Yeah, they're talking about it on the radio, and they're talking about it on the news, and it's on the front page of the paper. And it was in the paper the next day, and the next day, and the next day. And it was on Channel 3, Channel 5, Channel 13. In the morning, the noon, the night, the morning, the noon, the night. The night before the funeral at my Aunt Marianne's house, it was literally overflowing with people. They were coming in from all three doors. Everybody that knew me, everybody that knew my mom, everybody that knew anybody. It was overflowing. The people, the attention, the media, all of it was lifting me right out of reality into a grandeur that I can best describe as feeling like a celebrity. Thank you all for coming. Oh, goodness, there's beer and wine in the back. Oh, but please, let's all give a toast to my mother, Emily Kleiss Fisher. Funeral services were held at St. John's Methodist. Every maroon-colored pew in the large church was filled. I was surrounded in a cocoon of every aunt, uncle, cousin, second cousin I ever knew. We all listened to the music that was filled with harmony and dissonance. At times, it sounded like the score of a horror movie. And then the harmony would come back and remind you that the nightmare was over, but the damage remained. After the service, we're the first to leave the church. We walk outside and there are two stretch limousines waiting for us. My mother's sisters and brother head to the first limousine, and my father and brother head to the second limousine. Who should I ride with? Her side. Even my father spent more time with her side of the family. Oh, but he's alive, right? And she's not. Oh, but I'm closer to her side. Oh, but my Aunt Marianne's in that limousine, and as a child, she was like a movie star to me. She was tall and thin and wore chic clothes and sunglasses in the summer. And we used to all go out to Lucy's for her Easter extravaganzas. Gather round, children, gather round. Look, whoever finds the golden egg will win a goat. Oh, but fear not, children. Each child will take home a pet bunny. At which point, the parents would hide their gasp, sip their champagne. What the hell are we gonna do with a bunny?
Rebecca, you need to get in the car.
I look at my father, and he's pulling out a bottle of pills. Rebecca, you want a Valium? It'll help you relax. My brother reaches forth. Daddy, give me one of those. Marianne pipes back. Hubert, how many of those have you had? I don't know enough to get through talking through all these damn people. Rebecca, do you want a cigarette? We all smoked and leaned over one another. And as I sank into my turmoiled self, I found breaths of escape and the laughter abounding the car that got larger and larger as we made our way out Poplar Avenue. And somehow I was lifted from the exhaustion back into the exhilaration and the pomp and circumstances. Our driver led this very long, magnificent procession to bury my mother.
last name Hubert Frederick Fisher IV. But Mama thought the four sounded silly, so they compromised and saddled him with four names. Hubert Frederick Adrian Fisher, to be called Adrian after our great uncle Adrian. But those first few years, everybody called him Tank, because he was such a big baby. Not necessarily fat, just took up a lot of space. Rebecca, Adrian reminds me of your grandfather's Uncle Tom. He was notorious for starting fires, for no reason. Rebecca, Adrian's trouble started the moment your mother's egg was attacked by your father's sperm. Rebecca, Adrian got triangulated into your parents' marriage. I did some research. Triangulation. Besides being an algorithm, triangulation is when the unexpressed conflict between the parents is placed on the child. So let's see here. Let's get this out of the way. We would have my mother over here. Mm-hmm. She would be tired of my father's drinking, maybe other things. See? My father would be over here. Sick and tired of being picked on. And Adrian would be here. And I would be, wait a minute. I would be someplace out here. Okay, maybe out here. You saw what it was like in there. I mean, I literally had no point. But it's not so bad out here. I mean, out here I can make my own triangles of any shape or size. What, Mom? Come back here, Rebecca. I don't think it's fair that you go out and you spend the night so much when Adrian's at home and he doesn't have any friends. But Mom, Dad! Oh, Rebecca, Mama's got a point. I think it'd be nice if you stayed at home with your brother. You gotta remember, Adrian's not like you. He doesn't make friends as easily. At home, Adrian was peeing from the top of the stairs, starting fires, and nobody saying, son, there's better choices. Mama was like this wounded bird, always tending to him. Need anything? Coke! Anything else? Potato chips! Potato chips, we're out of potato chips. Hubert, get some potato chips! Adrian wants some potato chips! My father would run and get bags and bags of chips, you know, just in case the craving came back. Rebecca, Adrian's got a interbubular complex. What's that, Dad? Well, that's where the individual thinks that the world revolves between their boobs. Yeah, he's got an interbubular complex with an acute case of diafrippy. Boy, rocking around with such a big and rare complex. No wonder he spent so much time alone. When my parents used to fight, their voices would vibrate up through the master staircase and wake us up. First, Adrian. He'd come to the edge of his doorway dressed in his blue pajamas and his big head of blonde hair and his big, smooth belly sticking out, looking at me real hard, waiting for my eruption of tears. The summer I turned 12, and Adrian was still 7, this boy came over to do some yard work. He did about an hour of work, and then he stayed and he played with Adrian. His name was Leslie Shaw. That day, hope filled the house
just as the sun was setting. Schubert, maybe Leslie can come over next weekend and do some yard work and then play with Adrian. Emily, that's a good idea. Leslie, why don't I give you a ride home and we can talk about you coming over next weekend to do some work? Now, Leslie was black. And the only black people I'd seen in our house or in anybody's house were maids. Now, Lucy, she was extreme. But to a lesser extent, the image was the same. The Mallorys, they had Alma. Kathy had Estelle. Mary Ann had Mary Green. My grandmother had Sarah Mackey, followed by Liesta Redmond. And after my grandmother died, Liesta came to work for us. And there were days when Leslie would come over to play and Liesta was working there. And I would experience the supreme awareness that there were two black people in the house. And I would look for secret signs of communication between them, you know, that acknowledge the situation, like, I'm black and you're black, yep. And one of us doesn't work here, yep. But I didn't see any. The university club to which we belonged, typical country club of the 80s. No Jews, no single people, homosexuals didn't exist back then, and black people served and cooked the food. Rebecca Fisher, your order's here ready in the snack ball. Rebecca Fisher, your order's here ready in the snack ball. That's Cookie. She's young and pretty, and it seemed like she was always pregnant. She wore a blue uniform and her hair pulled back in a little ponytail every day. Hi, Cookie. There your French fries are. Where's your brother at? I ain't seen him today. Oh, he's at home. Well, you tell him Cookie said hello. That boy's so silly. Okay. When he was there, he was hanging around the snack bar talking to Cookie, or right outside the snack bar under the awning talking to Leo. Now, Leo must have been what you'd call a custodian. But he wasn't as well known by the rest of the kids because we didn't have to talk to him to get anything. Leo, you like his music? Oh, Adrian, it's okay. What about Big Daddy Kane? You like that? Adrian, you listen to that? Yeah, I like it. Hey, Rebecca. This is Leo. Hi. I walk into the snack bar and lean up against the tall black counter and reach for one of the little pencils to write my order. Your brother done almost filled up that snack bar ticket. I look at the pink, slightly wet, crumpled ticket. Hamburger, cheeseburger, slush puppy, candy, coke. Aaron Moran looks at my ticket. Gosh, our parents only let us get two items a day. All the other kids gather around to look at my ticket. Guy, your brother eats so much. Yeah, he does. You should see what he eats at home. I really wanted to cry for him, but that would be totally uncool. Next step, leave him behind. Cookie, I'll start a new ticket. The summer I turned 15, and Adrian was 12, Adrian brought Leslie to the club. I mean, he brought him inside the club. That was the day that private pool went public. Do you think Adrian and his friend are going to get into the pool? Well, surely the chlorine would kill any chemicals that boy might have in his hair. Yeah, surely. Black youth, he's as scared of you as you are of him. Please do not let this upset your stroke. Well, that certainly confirmed the general opinion that something was wrong about that Fisher boy. Inside, we all managed to deal with the shameful situation. Adrian, it's best you try not to do that again. It's just something you don't do. Oh, Hubert, I Just don't know why everyone has to make such a big deal about it. Well, I'm just glad I went to Camp Caudalia for 4 weeks that summer.
A friend of mine told me he thought Adrian was an exotic creature. You know, the way he could move from culture to culture with the ease and beauty of a chameleon. Another friend told me there was a word for people like Adrian, a wigger. I did some research. Wigger. A Caucasian male or female that takes on the personality of an inner city black. Similar to being bisexual, you will never be truly accepted by either side. Yo, that's one trifling ass wigger bust a G. Wigger, a white person who thinks he's down wit de brown. Down wit de brown. Someone needs to tell that wigger he's white. Wigger, a white person who thinks of himself as black and that they fit in the inner city black stereotype, usually live in the suburbs and dress black, pretending to be ghetto or from the hood, even though they've probably never been there and know nothing of what it's like. I don't know. Adrian didn't just hang out in the hood. You know, he had his own family in the hood. After Leslie, his best friend became Tion Williams. And he wasn't just friends with Tion, he was friends with Tion's whole family. Aaron, the brother, and Miss Austin, the mom. Adrian would smile so much when he talked about Miss Austin. He'd say, oh, Rebecca, I want you to meet her. She's so funny, especially after she has a couple beers. And she would call our house looking for Adrian. Is Adrian there? No, he's not. Well, can you tell him Miss Austin called? You know, Adrian is my godson. That's what I hear. But it was more than even Tion's family. You see, Adrian would cruise the hood. One time, we ran an errand for rolls and Cokes. And as we pull out on Union Avenue, Adrian turns left on McLean and heads right over the tracks into the Klondike neighborhood. As the neighborhood changes, he rolls down the windows. I lock the doors. He turns up his speakers that really pump up the bass. People notice us. And it's not because we're white. It's because they know Adrian. Hey, Snow, what's up? Oh, not too much. Maybe we should go home now. Oh, Rebecca, it's okay. Snow, what you doing? Oh, Doc, Launchpad. His name is Launchpad? Yeah, Rebecca, it's just a nickname. You guys gonna be here later on? I got my sister with me now. Yeah, we be here, Snow. Okay, they're gonna be here, so let's go home now. Rebecca, I was just about to drive home. As we pull away from the neighborhood, he rolls up the windows, turns off the music. We sit in silence. Why do they call you Snow? Oh, Rebecca, it's just a nickname. Mr. Fisher, during the time of your addiction, did you have a nickname?
Yes, sir, it was Snowball. A friend of mine gave it to me because I did a lot of powder cocaine and I used to buy it in increments of 8-Ball, which is a street name. I don't know how many grams that consists of, but that's usually how I bought it. Now, during the time of your addiction that you've just told the court and jury about, did you steal any items from your parents? I did. I was making any and every attempt to support my habit. That includes stealing bonds, forging checks. You see, besides Hubert, my father and I had the same name, which made it pretty easy to steal his bonds and forge his checks. But eventually, those accounts were frozen. I remember my father making jokes about those missing bonds. Where are my bonds? Yeah, Emily, I can't seem to find my bonds. We need to have a discussion about the missing bonds.
Then it became household items, those hard to deny. Hubert, was our TV here last night? I could have sworn we watched McNeil Lear. It was the bag of white powder that finally made it clear. Emily, I think Adrian's doing cocaine. What makes you say so? This. Yep, I think we should get more involved. We all headed out to Charter Lakeside Hospital, just like we did 6 years ago when my father stopped drinking. They never tell him no. I think it's really difficult for him. I don't think you seem to get it. I mean, he essentially runs the household. They never, never, ever tell him no! After my eruption of truth, silence fills the room. My parents, they look like paper dolls, all the air sucked out of them. My brother, half child, half beast. The therapist looking regular by comparison. Hubert, would you like to say anything about this? Well, Rebecca's always been a little bit emotional. Yeah. Rebecca's always been a little bit wound up. God grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change. The courage, I just want the courage, please. The courage to change the things I can, and the wisdom to know the difference. Please, the wisdom, I want the wisdom. I open my eyes, seeking a miraculous transformation of everybody in the space, only to see they've not changed at all. And I ask you, does this prayer ever work? It does work, maybe just not the way I thought. I moved up to Chicago, and thankfully I missed Adrian's treatment shuffle. I was admitted into Charter Lakeside Hospital. That lasted a week, if not less, but I went AMA, against medical advice. Following Lakeside, I entered treatment at Hazleton, where I was kicked out of, actually. Miss Fisher, why were you kicked out? I had someone send me marijuana through the mail, which, of course, is grounds for immediate dismissal. Then I went to a place in Mississippi, way down towards the middle of Mississippi, but I got kicked out of there. I had wanted to get kicked out of there, so I intentionally started a fight with someone. Then I went to a Memphis Recovery Center, and I walked out of there still dressed in my robe. You dress in these robes for 2 or 3 days, and I walked home wearing it, and my father was fed up. Finally, I started to get the idea that I was screwed up on drugs. I was messed up on drugs. So I went to Memphis Mental Health Institute. I did okay there. After that, I went to flew to Minneapolis and went to Progress Valley Halfway House. I graduated, maintained a job, then my mother was murdered. Now here we are today. I, in fact, stayed clean for quite a while now. I relapsed on the plane once I found word of my mother's death. Of course, relapse is part of recovery, but I stayed clean for quite a while now. My mother called me the Friday before she was killed. Rebecca, I think Adrian's doing drugs. People must have been calling the house, asking her for money, telling her Adrian owed them money. Hell, Adrian maybe gave him advice. Go over there, see my mom, she'll set you up. Okay, Mom, I'm gonna teach you how to say no. No. Oh, come on, Rebecca, that sounds so silly. I know it sounds silly, but just have some fun with it. Just try. Really firm and clear. No. No. Mm-mm. Okay, listen. Watch me. Does this work? No. Would you respect me? No. Okay. What about this? No. No. What about this? No, 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 no! Would you believe me? No. Okay. So what about this? Firm, clear, no. No. That's it, Mom. Keep practicing. No. 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 Maybe that's exactly what went wrong. Maybe she said something stupid like, no, and you boys need to get a job. Or maybe she said, no, and you're on drugs, aren't you? Why else would there have been such a terrible fight? They kept describing it as a brutal and violent murder. She was stabbed more than 50 times. After that, it got too hard to count. Stabbed in the chest, in the back, in the head, in the wrist, in the hands. Some of the wounds, 3 points.
1.6 inches deep. Those to the head, penetrating two to the skull, 2 inches deep. They left her there in a pile of blood, and Leesta Redmond gets free from upstairs, and she runs outside next door for help. Two years later, the case went to trial. George Tate and Rodney Blades were put up for capital punishment. Leesta Redmond was considered an incompetent witness because of her age and the trauma of the event and could not come forth and be reliable. And there was blood of another person that did not match Leesta, my mother, George Tate, or Rodney Blades. These brought valid doubt to the prosecution's case. Indictment for murder in first degree as to George Tate and Rodney Blades. The verdict reads as follows. We, the jury, find George Tate and Rodney Blades not guilty. We leave the courtroom. The cameras and reporters are here from Channel 3, Channel 5, Channel 13, and the redhead from Court TV. Nobody talks to the news. In fact, everybody ignores the news. We all leave the building and walk out, and everybody vibrates away from each other, holding their own pain. Dad and I return back to the house. Everything reminds me of Mom. I like to think she died feeling strong. Strong because she was sticking up for herself. But with each blow, she lost the strength to fight, and slowly she just drifted up, 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 away from the wreckage she couldn't get out of except through death. My father turns on the TV. A verdict came back regarding the Fisher trial. Both George Tate and Rodney Blades were found not guilty. We had a chance to interview the key witness and victim's son, Adrian Fisher. I think all in all it was a pretty good case and that the jury did their job. Although I didn't like the way he was talking about it like it was a football game and he was the star player, I did agree that the jury did their job. There was a still depressed feeling about the evening that I filled with alcohol and cigarettes. Still, it felt safer here than it did outside because here I could feel her presence.
Stolen, Mom.